Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome. Thank you very much for joining me. I'm Dr. Derek Da Silva. It's a pleasure to have you here with us. Joining me today is Dr. Anna Kubecka. We are at the 23rd Clinical Applications for Age Management Medicine Conference at the JW Marriott in Tucson, Arizona. And Dr. Kubecka is the recipient this year of the Alan Mintz Award for Excellence in Clinical Age Management Medicine. Anna, it is a pleasure to speak with you, and congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. It's quite an honor.
I mean, when we think about women and hormones and the management of women, you're an OBGYN, you're a board-certified OBGYN doctor who's been doing this for many years. You are our go-to person when it comes to women and women's health.
Thank you.
It's always been your passion. Tell me a little bit about how it all started.
Oh my gosh. Okay. So, you know, definitely passionate about women's health. And, you know, a lot of things when we enter a field of medicine like this with age management and just looking for alternatives to our standard care and our standard training, like we want to add things to our doctor's bag. And so our personal experience can drive this passion. And for me, it was definitely with my mother, who had heart disease from an early age, diabetes in her 30s, in her 50s, her first coronary bypass, actually at 52, 1 year older than I am now. So 52, her first coronary bypass. And so I really was interested in women's health and the research relating to women's health, and that was so sparse. I mean, in the 1980s, starting to dig into women's health and become an advocate, I recognized the deficiency in research in women and what we could do. So I was empowered with that, but also to look, as I recognized the polypharma and the symptom care versus treating the underlying issues that cause the problem, you know, is really what we need to be doing. And as, unfortunately, I say that I wish I knew then what I know now, because my mother passed away at 67, undergoing another heart surgery. And honestly, what was the cause of the problems were hormone imbalance and inflammation and adrenal dysfunction. And addressing those three issues, which I now call the devil's pitchfork, really makes a difference in changing that trajectory from illness and continued surgeries and continued medication to really one of wellness and being able to reverse that at any age and really in almost any condition. So I became passionate about that in my training at Emory University, and then in my clinical practice, being a solo OBGYN, a very rarity in today's, but I was in rural Georgia, southeast Georgia, below Savannah, a little shrimping village, and I had to get very creative on a budget in helping patients avoid surgery and avoid expensive medications. And so that fueled my passion, as well as working with women in sexual health. And I always relay the story of one of the first patients that came to see me when I ended up in Southeast Georgia was a woman of the 60s, really she was 63 years old, silver foxy lady, and she said, you know, she had ductal carcinoma in situ of the breast, her sex drive was in the pits, she had vaginal atrophy, and she'd rather die than live this way, what could I do? And so I had to dig into what we could do, and bioidentical hormone replacement with testosterone was a very viable option. So that started me back in 1999 working in these modalities, and it's made a difference in thousands, tens of thousands of women's lives.
What was your biggest challenge when you started, and has that challenge been resolved, and what's your biggest challenge today?
Ah, that's a great question. So I think the biggest challenge when I started way back, you know, initiating my practice, was that no one else was doing it. Very few.
And when you say doing it, you're talking about hormones,
bioidentical hormones, okay. Testosterone replacement in women specifically. And so very few people were doing that. And functional medicine was just starting, and age management medicine was just starting to be birthed, really, at that time. And so there were a few resources. So tying into those groups made a big difference. So that has helped, creating this tribe of other physicians that practice clinically based medicine that changes, transforms life. So that's been a huge issue. We still struggle. Pharmaceutical companies, insurance companies are huge barriers. Really, mafiosa medicine. We can call it mafiosa medicine, forcing the hand of doctors to go with protocols versus, you know, the art of medicine, practicing the art of medicine. So we face that in tremendous levels today.
Any challenge? So has that resolved? Has that gotten better? What's your perception of that?
It is getting better because we have more research that has looked at bioidentical hormone replacement and functional medicine. We have more integrative, you know, the American Board of Integrative Medicine just became an ABMS certified board mm-hmm. certification. And I just certified in that, so I'm triple board certified. And so now we're getting some real recognition in our American Medical Association communities right. with the integrative approach. And so that's been huge. That's helping, but we're still a minority, 1% maybe.
True. Yeah. What does the future look like? When you look into your crystal ball, what do you
which
see?
Which one? No.
Which one? I mean, maybe you do have more than one crystal ball, but the crystal ball that you look into, what do you see in the future?
So I see women and men. And I my OBGYN background, I'm advocate and I primarily work with women and the men who love them. Mm-hmm. What I see is women becoming their own advocate and their own, you know, I want to say doctor, mm-hmm. clinician, their own problem solver, because 90% of what we recommend in age management are therapeutic lifestyle changes. That's in charge of the individual. 10%, you know, I'll claim 10% that, you know, I can fine tune, optimize, etc.
Right.
But 90% of what we need, of what a patient needs to do to get well, is within their lifestyle, optimizing their lifestyle, not our standard American lifestyle, but really holistic lifestyle based on our genetics, based on our microbiome, and that's changing. I see women empowered in healing themselves, mm-hmm. and that affecting the generations.
I see exactly what you just said.
Thank you.
People empowering themselves. For example, my sons are 32 and 28. They're being very proactive with regard to, hey, Dad, do I need to do some blood work? Do I need to check my cholesterol? Do I need to check my blood sugar?
Nice.
That's what I'm hoping that we pass on to the next generation. Mm-hmm. And is that what you're seeing?
Yes. Well, I definitely, you know, I have four daughters, and so like a big part of my passion is to create a healthcare system that's actually supportive of the human design mm-hmm. versus, big pharma or monetization of medicine. And I say that seriously because that's what I've seen. So I want a healthcare system that empowers the individual. And that's not what we have right now. But I really feel like this new generation coming up is aware, is smart enough mm-hmm. to start saying, you know what, I need to choose the non-GMO. I need to choose the organic. I need to be out in nature. I need to have a minimalization or simplistic and focus on the simple things in life versus the, you know, race of the Joneses that we really had in the 80s and 90s. So I see this new generation coming up with that desire to be empowered and educated.
Obviously for the perimenopausal, the menopausal woman, bioidentical hormones. But before we get into menopause, what is your recommendation what are your recommendations to women to continue their road to health for the 30 and 40 year old?
Yeah, no, I think with that's where our hormone changes are starting. DHEA is starting to decline, progesterone is starting to decline, and those two hormones are really powerful. So we want to do things that honor that. So there's that life balance, right? Saying more no's than yeses, maybe, to obligations, stresses, ambitions, and really creating that balance. And then using nutritional support. So a keto alkaline, getting into ketosis, intermittent fasting, really looking at alkalinizing diet, foods that are, you know, homegrown, mm-hmm. you know, pick it, peel it, fish it, hunt it, milk it, grow it, right? Stay away from gluten, stay away from GMOs. Do these smart things that really can empower health. And those are changes that have to be done. Detoxification regimens because of the increase in endocrine disruptors like birth control pills, like the pesticides, herbicides that we're exposed to. So these 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds have to go through these nutritional detoxification programs and, you know, healing digestive tract, healing the adrenals to support mm-hmm. them. And we do that with herbs like maca, like, you know, quercetin, turmeric, resveratrol, you know, and in these health, again, activity, exercise, movement, and relational activities, having good community, having good friendships, not having the ideal dream of being, oh my gosh, Derek, I mean, I always joke about this. I said, you know, the ideal dream on the commercials is to be on the beach with a laptop and, you know, you're sipping margaritas, but they're always pictured alone. Number one, you can't see the screen of a laptop when you're on the beach. Right. I mean, you can't do that anyway. And then you're alone, you're depressed, you're gonna, you know, like there's suicide mm-hmm. waiting to happen, right? It's just not how we're designed. We're designed in community. So I wanna see that brought back. And that's important to see that because our relationships start to decompensate and we start to get burnt out and hence an increased rate of divorce. So we wanna balance the hormones. And then bioidentically, using bioidentical progesterone, using DHEA, and again, herbal support to help those hormonal balance and detoxification. So your body can use more of what is naturally produced mm-hmm. than having to supplement. And that early on, when we make those changes early on, we avoid hysterectomy, we avoid incontinence, we avoid depression, we avoid anxiety, we avoid palpitations, we avoid the weight gain, we avoid the hair loss, all those, like, you know, the seven dwarves of menopause or the seven deadly mm-hmm. aspects of menopause. And we have to start early. The earlier we start, the better longevity and quality of life we have.
As we come to the end of this, we've got about a minute left. Give me your keys to success and a healthy life.
Well, I definitely think when it comes to the primary key to success, I think our major hormone is oxytocin. So when that is the love and bonding hormone, the hormone of connection, the juice of life, right? The what we want to put on our epitaph at our, you know, at when we die, you know, what does our tombstone want to read? It wants to read, I loved my children loved me, or I loved my family, my community loved me. And that sense of, you know, sense of real relationship that we had at the end of life. So that's oxytocin. Mm-hmm. So we do that by oxytocin and cortisol can run opposition with each other, and cortisol being the stress hormone. When we have that imbalance, you know, high cortisol or chronic burnout of cortisol, oxytocin's depleted and we disconnect. And so my pearl is to do things that you enjoy, to invest in your relationship, in your marriage, your most important people around you, your family, your kids, and invest in that time. You know, vacation well, take time off, get into nature, ground, increase your vibrational, energetic frequency mm-hmm. through those restorative practices that really restore your body as a whole and restore your relationships. So that is primarily. And then from a nutritional lifestyle aspect, you know, diet is 25% of the solution. We have to look at the other aspects of lifestyle. So definitely all those oxytocin mm-hmm. increasing activities, number one. And then, you know, intermittent fasting, prolonged fasting, you know, a ketogenic or ketosis, getting into ketosis, and I will say keto alkaline, getting enough greens and natural detoxifiers that really help support your cell membrane, because when it comes down to it, that's the way we function. That's our cellular communication. When we're getting to the underlying issues, we want healthy cell membrane. So getting alkaline, getting into ketosis, giving your body rest time, mm-hmm. and really focusing on oxytocin are the pearls, are the lifestyle changes that empower us to have a joyful life.
joyful life.
No matter what we're experiencing,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
To be the eye of the storm or the ocean, not the waves, because we're going to have trials and tribulations. But to stay centered, to stay peaceful, to stay connected, and that's the key.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Pleasure to have you here. Thank you for that wonderful piece of advice. And folks, I hope you listened to that, and I hope you learned something from that. I thank you very much for joining us. As always, pleasure to have you here with us. I'm Dr. Derek DeSilva, and until next time, may you always be blessed with good health.